Now on BBC World Service, Nick Rankin visits a rather unusual museum in suburban South London to explore the wireless world of Gerry Wells.
Switcher on, fire up.
This is a programme about a man from another age.
Yeah, we got vaults here.
It's a portrait of a craftsman with an obsession for radio.
Well, we're getting a reading.
Gerry Wells has spent his life making and repairing wireless sets.
Yes. Theoretically, we should get a crack or we should be getting noise.
His memories are the music and sounds of a bygone era.
Signs of life.
Final emails on where Michael Winner should be buried. Stephen Heath suggests up to his neck at low tide.
Digital radio, I can't listen to it. The sound is thin, weak and anemic. It hasn't got that warm, round sound that you can hear here on any of the apparatus. And there's some lovely examples of what that nice, warm, round sound is like.
Gerry Wells is a genial Dickensian figure in spectacles, wearing his habitual grubby white lab coat with a screwdriver and a pencil in the top pocket. He's the personification of a wispy-haired boffin.
Master volume, bass and treble.
And he still lives in the home where he was born over 80 years ago. It's a solid, red-brick Victorian family house with the outside woodwork painted what he calls middle-class green. The house is not just his home, but also a world-renowned museum. Rooms are packed with microphones, glass, valves, batteries, and all kinds of artifacts from the world of radio. Above all, there are old wireless sets everywhere.
This is the Daventry room.
This room has hung with lights. It's got a clear story as well above it, which is lovely, and these Tudor beams. But it's these gleaming brown models of Bush and what other make of radios. I can't imagine. I've never seen so many radios.
Well, we've got 1,200 here altogether, the whole establishment, apart from 100 maturing in black bin liners up in the loft, because we haven't got room to display them.
Who were the really good manufacturers whose craftsmanship and work you really admire?
Murphy, HMB, Marconi, Columbia, Bush, Phillips, of course. And this room houses the monsters, the big beasts. You've got the Murphy A28RG, which is a very fine radiogram. It had automatic frequency control, which in 1936 was a new innovation. That meant you couldn't mistune it. And Murphy's, in their advertising material, said, ideal for women users. They always reckon a woman can't tune a radio in. It got him into trouble. We had political correctness even in those days. But you couldn't mistune it. It was wonderful. It stayed on. This was a room I was born in, on this spot. So born in this room, conceived in that one. And this is what a wireless shop would have looked like in 1936. The normal traditional shop counter with ornamental sign over top saying MacMichael Radio, an early type telephone, a test meter, and a 1936 copy of Radio Times. Every wireless shop would have a Radio Times on the counter. Also a valve tester on the counter, so you bring your valves in from your radio and have it tested. And all the different kinds of light bulbs.
Also, Gerry Wells has been completely obsessed with all things electrical since the day he was born.
Something about electricity that fascinated me from the very, very beginnings. Wherever I went, if I was taken anywhere, I would look for electrical fittings, light fittings, ceiling roses, sockets, anything to do with electricity.
Now, was it light itself? Was it the light coming on, do you think, as a baby?
I don't think it was a light coming on that was fascinating. It was the shape and the colour of the shades, the lanterns. When they took me down to Margate for my first seaside holiday, when I must have been about two and a half, and we stayed at a boarding house run by a Mrs. Epps. I wasn't interested in the seaside. I was fascinated by the lovely big red light shade that's hung in the front hall of her boarding house, and I'd stare at it for hours. So when I was a small child, playing at the bottom of the garden at 3 or 4 years of age, my sisters and my friends would be out on the lawn dancing to the radiogram which pushed into the French windows.
Music through the window, sent specially to housewives by the makers of Phosphorine Tonic Wine and presenting Gordon Little in a programme of song.
Gerry was rather an unusual child. He liked to collect bits of electrical equipment and hoard them in the den he'd made down at the bottom of the garden.
But it was my play area, my little empire. It was dry, it was not terribly clean, but it was safe. I could do what I liked down there. I could salvage all these bits of wood and try and make sheds.
You built shelters, didn't you? Definitely you wanted to build sheds or shelters or houses.
Yes, exactly. Some sort of protection. Somewhere where I could put all my light bulbs, dud switches, bits of wire, anything I could pick up from relations, shops, anything else.
That's what you call... I mean, first of all, you built the shelter, and then you had these treasures that you put in the shelter, as it were. Tell me about these treasures.
I was pulling light bulbs around on bits of string and hanging them off of the branches of trees and imagining they were lights. And neighbours started giving me odd fittings lying around I think they had no use for, and old lamp holders, old switches, wood blocks, lumps of wire, anything connected to electricity. They were my treasures.
In 1936, Gerry's mother said to him, "If you don't buck your ideas up and conform, you'll still be mucking about at the bottom of the garden in 50 years' time." Well, she was right. That's where Gerry's workshops are today, at the bottom of his garden, where he can be found in his extensive shed, pottering and tinkering, taking things apart and putting them together again, fixing and servicing radios for all sorts of unexpected and eccentric people who turn up.
It's not a hobby. It's a way of life.
But it's not real, is it?
Oh, it's real enough.
What are you doing, Gerry?
Listening and diagnosing. Now, for a start, quite a layer of dust in it, which will blow out. I mean, most of the trouble is down to what we call Hunt's condensers. A.H. Hunt Limited manufactured condensers. They were the cheapest, nastiest condenser on the market. Every manufacturer used them because they're at least halfpenny a dozen cheaper than anybody else. Hello. Yes?
Hello?
Hello?
It's Norma and me.
Ah, yes. Oh, yes, will you come in? Oh, yeah. Hello, hello. Do come in. I'm just in the middle of an interview. Do come in.
Do you want us to wait outside?
No, you can stand over here and listen, because we're... Yes, this is... This is Mr. Ashby, who's a beekeeper extraordinary.
Yes, from extraordinary.
And his friend Norma, who restores paperwork.
And who are the two gentlemen here?
They're from World Service.
BBC.
Just doing an
you
interview.
Not BBC. Can
you
go away?
No, you don't. No, come
wait,
on.
Not at all. This is all human life is here.
Yeah. She's come down to collect her radio, which has been tidied up, cleaned up, sorted out.
Miss Wells, you know I talked to you about my televisions.
Yes.
Well, I took them to Slough, and they said they couldn't get the parts.
No, you wouldn't do it now.
No. He gave me the parts, and the man, the mechanic chap, the repairman, said, actually, it's an easy job to do, but he couldn't do it because he doesn't get the parts. So I'm going to collect them in Slough. And I wondered if I came here on Sunday, I could let you look at them.
Well, I won't look at them because I won't touch television. I don't like it.
I see.
But there's John, who I think is up the house at the moment.
He was sitting in the kitchen eating a sausage roll.
That would be John, yes.
Okay.
But it'd be a vegetarian sausage roll, I'm certain.
It smelt like a meat sausage roll to me.
Don't tell him.
Okay, so can I go and talk to him quickly before he goes?
Yes, you can, yes.
Okay.
It's John Thompson I want to speak to.
Okay.
Tell me who you are, what you are, and what you've done.
Okay.
And,
sorry to interrupt your interview.
That's quite all right, then.
Thank you very much. Goodbye.
Thank you.
You never know who you're going to meet in Gerry's shed. It's the nerve centre of his vintage wireless empire, an Aladdin's cave of radio bric-a-brac. His workbench, scarred green linoleum on oak under a pool of light from a hanging lamp, is covered with pliers and screwdrivers, parts from a gutted radio, a voltmeter, valves, soldering irons. Shelves are packed with tiny boxes and tobacco tins holding fuses, screws, condensers, next to fading old radio manuals and directories. Tangles of coloured wire hang in festoons. Gerry Wells is a guru who teaches his craft to disciples.
Yes, it's a fine Sunday morning in West Dulwich, British West Dulwich, and it's bloody cold, and we're having our Sunday workshops. We have about four times per year where maybe half a dozen people can bring two radios each. We supply all the parts, all the test instruments for benches, and an instructor, one instructor for every two people, a hot meal, and we teach them how to repair their own radio. They don't need a lot of experience. As long as they can use a screwdriver and a soldering iron, then they're all right. And they don't go home till they've fixed them.
And that grunting noise is men carrying large radios,
yes,
through the door.
Yes.
The green door of your workshop.
They're just turning up now, and we've got 8 out of 9 turned up so far.
Well, we'll try and keep out of the way.
No, you don't. You just mingle. You just do as you like, talk to whoever you like. And it's not so much a teaching or a masterclass, it's also a social event.
Who's found himself a bench? Oh, Ian's got his usual pole position.
Right. Can we just briefly interrupt you? What have you brought in and what's the problem?
It's a 1938 Murphy A72 radio. The problem is it's so old that a lot of the wiring is decayed.
It looks very venerable. I mean, this looks as if it's been dug up, more or less.
Gerry tells me it is fixable, so we're going to have a go.
So I've got. So you're going to strip it down, more or less, and rewire it?
Start again.
Yeah.
I've got the rest of the bits in the car, but I didn't want to bring the rest of the stuff across in case I was told it was just a sad case and it was past it. But he tells me it's not.
As the Sunday workshop proceeds, it's a bit like listening to a foreign radio station broadcasting from another world, full of technical jargon and bizarre sounds.
Motorboating. It's a low-frequency oscillation, and it sounds like a motorboat, doesn't it?
One side of your mains, other side of your mains. Now, on the set it is at the moment, you've got a line called resistance, which I'm drawing thus.
I forgot that it was higher up on the medium wave. I was sitting around the light program area almost.
Now, the bulb goes where?
On the heater chain, right. And it goes, it clips into here, so it illuminates the dial.
So then, all right, so when you switch on, you know it's on.
Yes.
By tea time, signals are emerging from noise, and technical resistance has been overcome, though the explanations can be rather baffling to the uninitiated.
So, just to explain again, simply what you did, what Gerry identified, what did you do to fix this?
We changed the dropper resistor, which had gone open circuit on one leg. We changed the coupling capacitor to the output valve, snipped off pin 4 of the output valve to stop mains hum, and changed the tone control capacitor on top of the output transformer.
So you do that, and then it works?
And it works.
The Sunday workshops are where Gerry Wells is happily in his element. But his path hasn't always been an easy one. Actually, his road has been rather rocky. As a child during the Second World War, his fanatical love for things electrical got him into trouble. He was so keen to get hold of electrical bits and bobs that he took to stealing them. Gerry Wells was a wartime looter.
By the time I was 12, it was just a nasty little tow rag. Nothing was safe. They got me before the juvenile courts for destroying all the electrics in local church halls, air raid shelters, removing light fittings and stuff from bombed property. Eventually, I ended up before one of the country's top psychiatrists, the Stanford House Remand Home, who gave me every possible sort of test there was, you see. And his conclusion was, well, you've got an obsession. And I said, I could have told you that.
Gerry was caught by the police on more than one occasion, and it was a brutal shock for a middle-class adolescent to find himself locked up with some of the roughest boys in London.
Your Stanford House Remand Home in Shepherd's Bush was a hellhole. Kids out of East End of London, out of everywhere. It was nasty, horrible kids. Didn't speak the same language as me at all. The only high spot was that every morning, Captain Hanvey, the superintendent of Stamford House, would assemble together and play us two records. We all had to sit absolutely still and quiet while he played these two records. Usually a bit of Bach. His favourite one being Jesus Joy Man's Desiring. It was the first time I'd heard Bach or that type of classical music. And I was thrilled by that, and I loved that. It meant nothing to the other kids. It meant a lot to me. The tranquility and peace of it was beautiful.
In 1944, aged 15, Gerry Wells was sent to the northwest of England, to Redbank School, an institution that tried to rehabilitate young offenders by teaching them practical skills. The governor, John Vardy, asked young Gerry what his problem was. "I have an obsession with radio and electricity," he said. "Have you now?" said Mr. Vardy. "Funny that. I've the same trouble with a certain member of my staff."
Reg Yates was a man referred to by John Vardy who had also an obsession for radio and electricity.
What did he look like?
Looked like a Welsh miner. Short, little flat cloth cap, brown coat with a pair of pliers in his top pocket. He was friendly, he said, "I've got a radio here, it's giving me bother." It's Philco, 444. He says that all it does is make a lot of whistles and pick up world service, all over the dial. I knew that meant the oscillator isn't working. And I immediately saw what had happened. There's a little wire coupling between the two halves of a tuning condenser. One is soldered, the other is wrapped round to form a small condenser. And somebody had soldered that onto the other half side of the tuning condenser, which killed the oscillator stone dead. So I snipped that through or untwisted it. Up came a set, good as new, in about half a minute or so. So he said, "Ecky thump," which is a Lancashire word for astonishment. I had a blessed existence after that. And John Vardy said, "You're not wrong with this lad. He likes radio and electricity."
And so a career was born. The obsession that could have been his downfall now became Gerry's livelihood and his salvation. He set up his own business, bought a van, serviced radios across South London, and had a nice line installing tannoy loudspeakers and rewiring cinema sound systems. Looking back, he believes he's been lucky.
There's not everybody, like myself, who are doing for a living work that they like. Most people work to live. So, and while I was still at school, and I was told quite severely that we can't do for a job the things we like doing. All the whole family were doing work we didn't like.
But for you, because of the passion, because of the obsession, it hasn't seemed like drudgery, really.
No, it's been for fun. It's all been a laugh.
It's characteristic of the wartime generation to keep cheerful in adversity. But the truth is, Gerry Wells also suffered as Great Britain declined after the Second World War. New technologies were not always improvements. More was not always better. Has television eclipsed radio in the 1950s? Has the transistor replaced the valve in the 1960s? And has digital replaced analog? There was also a slow loss of skill and craft. Gerry Wells is clear about when Britain made its best radios.
1936. We reached our peak then. We produced some magnificent equipment. We haven't really beaten it. We've got quite a fine car industry, a mechanical industry. We were a workshop of the world. The Americans were making radios cheap and cheerful, and they worked, but we made them so they lasted forever. And those radios were made in 1936, are still around and still give fantastic results compared to the modern stuff.
What do you think that says about Britain now, that 1936 should be our peak?
Well, just look around you. Just look at the papers. Just look at the shops. Just look at the state of things. Just listen to the radios. Listen to the programmes. It's gone downhill completely.
Keeping up standards when so much around is slipshod may seem impossible. But it's an admirable thing to do when workmanship, artistic quality and attention to detail are at stake. You have to respect Gerry Wells for his enduring loyalty to the ideal of radio and how he's kept faith with the craftsmanship he loves.
I don't intend to retire. So die on the saddle, as it were.
There's something noble about doing things well.
Oh, I'm not going to retire, can't. What would I do? Sit down and watch television? Not bloody likely.
The Wireless World of Gerry Wells was presented by Nick Rankin and produced by Dan Shepherd. It was a Falling Tree production for BBC World Service.